Can you hear me? Yeah, so very pleased to be with you today, and we're going to spend 18 minutes together. So very pleased to spend some time, and the subject here is what's going to happen in the next 15 to 20 years. So it's hard to predict, but what we know at least is that there is a future of system. The way we have been building system in the future will never be the same starting now and in the coming future. So I'm Yves Bernert, and I'm leading technology, Accenture Technology in Europe. So this is a team focusing on new technology every single day, not about only the big partners like the SAP, Oracle, and the other, but all about custom development. So the first thing I really want to pass as a message is that, I don't know for you, but I've been in technology for the last 28 years. And in the last 28 years, this is what I saw happening. I saw technology coming to us very slowly, right? I mean, the mainframe and the client server and all that thing was coming very slowly. And then, you know, if I go back to there, all the latest one, including AI, including quantum computing, including blockchain, is coming at a speed that never happened before. So as technologists, we have to organize ourselves to embrace those technologies in a very, very quick way. And the way to develop those technologies has nothing to do with what we did before. So what we really encourage, that it's not only anymore technologists, I don't know how much technologists are in this room, or business leader, but it's about getting everyone together. When you think about a new project, it's not about technology for technology. It's about how we're going to use blockchain to improve a supply chain process for the retail industry. So there is no way as technologists we can work alone. So we can't work in the old model with the V model to get the requirements and move on, etc. And we can't give us a long time to learn of those new waves coming. So that's the first message I wanted to pass. The second message is that we saw that, you know, if you look back to the station that was sent to the space at that time with Apollo, if you compare to a Nintendo station, it was just like double the size in terms of compute capacity. That was about it. That's about it today. So it's very true that there is no limit today in the computing. There is no limit in the data storage or cloud capacity. We have to think very differently around all the new development will be around data, but not the big data, but the data veracity. How are we able to secure the data? And how are we going to implement new AI solutions? Because the way we develop software will be very different than in the past, but I will come to that. So what I want to focus is on few messages. And there are three messages on the way we're going to develop system in the future. The first one is what we call boundary-less. Or I could, maybe an English term as a French, it's not easy to say, frictionless business. Business, they can't work in silo anymore. When you are in retail, you have to collaborate with all your supply chain. You have to collaborate with telco clients. You have to collaborate with your partner, your supplier, everyone. So a system can only be developed thinking about who do we need to connect at any time. So when you are like a pharmacy Walgreens and you want to implement a partnership on your loyalty program, for them, they did it with 275 partners in 6 months. How? It's because the way we develop system today has changed. So we had the legacy, and that's what we are. If you are CIO, you have your legacy. You can't transform totally your legacy. So the legacy, whether it's the ERP or everything, first, it has to move to the cloud. There is no way to develop APIs or, you know, connect to the world keeping the legacy as it is. So we believe that in the next few years, like IDC has stated, 80% of new apps will be developed in the cloud. But as well, the legacy must move to the cloud. So even there is a mainframe, there are ways to move that to the cloud. So then we can develop application around, and we don't need to interconnect with an on-prem system. So that's the first message. The other message I want to pass on it is that we need to think about decoupling the stack. Because if even you move the legacy to the cloud, it will not be as agile as it can be. So you have to decouple the legacy, and the new application in order to develop your new system. So keeping the legacy, but moving it to the cloud, modernize it, developing microservices and APIs, and then developing the new application. So they are, you are able to connect your system, not waiting 1 or 2 years, but doing extremely quick, being very agile in the way you deliver your solution. The next message is around adaptable system. In the past, I think we were developing system where we were taking time to collect user requirements. We were taking time, you know, to develop it, to test it, etc. This time is totally over. So an adaptable system, for me, is a system where we can immediately integrate new functions. So when I say we develop APIs and we develop microservices, it helps to immediately adapt the system. So it's not it will not take ages anymore to connect new features that the business is asking you. But more important, I believe, the way when we refer to data and AI, instead of developing functions in the past, a new functions will be part of the AI algorithm. Okay? So it means that the system, as it goes, will learn by itself. So some stuff that were before a fixed code, like, you know, with an entry point, a process, you know, there are triggers for a process, and then there is a standard outcome, this is over. The algorithm will adjust by itself. So something that was developed before as a code will become an AI algorithm. So we'll not have to code it anymore. Right? And more important, what we start to see is when you use AI, you can even automate some code generation. So when you develop your system, then it becomes not pure fixed code anymore, but the AI tool will help you to generate your own code. But not only. When that code or the algorithm is developed, the way we were testing things before. So I don't know for you, but we were testing things based on clear script. You know, we had the user requirement, we transform them in script, we execute the script, and we check whether it is the same. So we'll still do a bit of it. But what has to be done is to do what I will call teach and test. An AI algorithm is going to need to be not only tested, but we're going to have to teach it. An AI algorithm is just like our kids. When you have kids, you have to tell them what is good, and you have to tell them what is bad, right? So an AI tool, let's take a basic example, like translation. When you go to any translation tool on the web, and you, for example, you type stuff like, she is a doctor, right? You make the translation happen to Turkish. So if Turkish people are there, you know, you will tell me what it is. But if you take it back immediately back to English, the system will tell you, he is a doctor. From she is to he is. If you type things like, you know, she is a babysitter, the system will bring you back, I mean, you can try it, she is a babysitter. So it's totally biased. So those basic things, it's not about programming, it's about teaching. So when you are in the testing business, you need to move to the teach and test, because the system will make automatic decision, or it will advise business leader to take decision based on the algorithm. So the only way to go around that, and you can ask any big company doing AI, this is their main problem: how to teach the system, because it's all based on the historical data that I have put on the web, that you have put on the web, all of us have put on the web, and some of it are just biased or they are wrong. And that's the only way, is to teach the system. So that's going to be one of the new ways, not only about developing system, but I think testing new system. So that is all about adaptable system. If you move to the next theme, it's about the way we develop user interface. I don't know for you, but we were always developing system based on, you know, what we believe the technology can help us to design as a screen. This is totally over. Now we need agency people to think of the user interface. We don't need any more technologists. We're going to use technologists to help us to design, but we need agency people who design product to develop user interface. That's the type of the new job. So stuck in 1874, why? Because at that time, that's the time where the keyboard was invented. And you all may agree that the keyboard is still a bit the same, maybe smaller, maybe harder to use, right? At least for me. And what we strongly believe in the coming years is that the keyboard is out, the keyboard is over. It's not about the new release of the keyboard is over, the screens are over, and it's all going to be about extended reality, what I will call as well the end of distance. The way we're going to interact with systems is going to be by voice, it's going to be by gesture. So that's what I will call, I moved now to the radically humans. So the third theme about the new way to develop system is around the system will be radically human. So all keyboards, everything out. So it's two things. It's the way it is designed through designer, not technologist, pure designer, thinking the user experience to have a love index on the product that is pretty high. It's not about whether it is nice or not. It's whether people want to use it or not. And again, it's going to be around XR. It's going to be about voice recognition. It's going to be about gesture recognition. That's the new way. So we need new skills to develop this new type of system. And of course, we're going to have to look at new ways to design and go through different, new steps to develop those new user interface. But in order to do this, the future of systems, so you got it, huh? Boundary-less, if you go back to the key message, I go there, yeah, boundary-less, adaptable system, so the code remains extremely flexible and adjusts by itself, not only through the AI algorithm, but as well regenerate the code by itself. Even in the maintenance system, tickets will be managed automatically. No need to enter anything and to correct. If we have the solution in the back, because we did the correction of the ticket in the bus multiple times, it's going to be to production immediately without any human interaction. And then the last message around radically humans. But in order to do that, the people we have, and the people in Accenture we had 7 years ago, are not the people we have today. The way we manage it, and some people say from the World Economic Forum that by 2020, one-third of the skills we're going to need to develop system or to operate are not skills that we had at that time. So it's a massive rotation. So the way we manage it, and if you are CIO or you lead an IT team or you need a business, you have to define what means new to you. So in a system development, what are the new type of user interface you need to develop? How do you develop a boundary-less system? How do you develop an adaptable system? So you need new skills that you don't have today in your team. So that's the thing we did. We said, this is the skills we need in the next 5 years. That was 7 years. And we trained, in Accenture, there is like 450,000 people. And in the first 18 months, we had to train like 200,000 people. That's the way we've been driving the change. In order to create the skills, you need to develop those new systems. So this one-third of the skills, I think in every team that you lead, you have to think about the skills you're going to need in the next 1 or 2 years, not spending years to create, but do it immediately through digital learning boards that includes AI, so you can do personalized training to your own employees. So therefore, you need new talent in order to develop the new type of system. And in order to get the new talent, you need to go through all those steps to rethink totally the talent you need. And it's even when you are a technologist and you want to implement an automation, like an RPA system, with AI. I mean, we know that every company will become an intelligent enterprise. So it's not about doing basic automation. It's about doing automation with RPA plus AI. In the next few years, people say, maybe tasks, not jobs, most of them will be automated, like in accounting, 40%. That's true. But you have to manage. For us, when we do it, we say we're going to do it if and only if we can help you in the talent rotation. Because the job rotation that's going to have to be managed is massive. So you can't do the technology implementation or the process change without doing the talent rotation. So you have to go through this. And the last message I would like to say is, when you are in technology and you are looking at a deep technology, when you want to develop adaptable system, boundaryless system, or radically human system, the main key thing is how you're going to do innovation. How you're going to do innovation. So in many companies, I don't know yours, but innovation is spread everywhere in the business, not only in tech, but in every business unit. They do MVP sometime, and then it's done. Nothing else happening. So what we believe is the way it has to operate is what I will call setting up not only the best tech team and the best business team doing innovation, but getting them physically together. So that's what I will call creating digital factory. What is a digital factory? It's a place where you put your best strategy people, the best business leader people, the best technology people, the best startup people that we have here in the Web Summit, at a physical place, and all the innovation from that company goes there. And everyone is working on an agile team of 5 to 10 people, mix of business, company like us, startup, strategic people, and technologist experts. They shape the new idea, they scrum, then they try the new idea, they develop it, and then it goes back to the business unit when the MVP is ready to go to production. Because there is so many people spending millions of millions in every siloed organization in the company, that if you don't bring the innovation at one place where you do the research, you do the venture relationship with all the startup, even you do acquisition, you don't have a liquid studio mindset where you can prototype your idea. That's what you need to have, like your innovation center as well needs to be at one place. And when it's done, then you move it to the place where you can scale it. But that's, for me, the only way to operate. So that's my recommendation. When you look at the next 15 to 20 years, everything's going to change. We know it. A lot of stuff's going to be automated. Company will generate more revenue by new product putting technology in. They will improve their bottom line by more automation, more AI. But at the same time, we will need new technologies type of skills to do boundary-less system, adaptable system, so less piece of code because that's going to be automated, and more radically human user interface. Those are the three things. But to do it, get a people strategy to see how you're going to rotate not only your technology people, but all the rest to this new, and get them in what I call a digital factory mindset and physical location to make that real, to make that come true, because that's the only way, I believe, you can do innovation at scale. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.